Audiobook Shelf presents The Lives of the Pirates. Swashbucklers, Scoundrels, Neighbors Beware. Read by Ray Childs and Kymberly Dakin. Now and then, we had a hope that if we lived and were good, God would permit us to be pirates. Mark Twain.
Lives of the Pirates, Introduction. As soon as ships started sailing, people popped up to rob them. Fleeing their landlocked lives, pirates sailed the seven seas for adventures in stealing. Think outlaws, think criminals, violent, hairy, crude, and rude, and not all of them were men. These were rebels, but with a cause, flouting authority, living lives as free as the wind, challenging unfair rules. Can it be coincidence that so many pirate ships have revenge as part of their name? True, they were robbers, but they were often underdogs as well, fighting against society's laws, armies and navies, and whole governments. They were bullies, but also team players, governed by their own democratic rules, surviving danger in exotic island locations. No role models here. Several did play a part in world history, but mostly these were daring and dangerous criminals who made scant contributions to civilization, unlike many famous musicians, artists, and writers, and yet, aided by the flow of entertaining pirate-themed books and movies, we continue to be fascinated with pirates, usually thinking of them in a romantic, idealistic way. But what were they like as real people? Alas, except for the dates of their executions, hard information is difficult to come by. Usually running from the law, pirates avoided publicity. Most didn't have marriage ceremonies, own houses, pay taxes, or take notes. Essentially homeless, they didn't often have next-door neighbors who might have tattled. Respectable scholars, past and present, have tended not to devote their time to pirate research. Instead, far from the sea, writers with brawny imaginations have sat at their desks, spinning pirate stories and embellishing them for dramatic effect. That's why we have many more myths and legends than reliable facts about pirates. One of the two greatest myths about pirates is that they were likable swashbucklers with a colorful way of talking. That image comes from Hollywood. We do know that real pirates were not all alike. Most did swear a lot, but which one got loot by sneaking her hand under the mattresses of sleeping captains? Who made his crew drink their own urine? Which one spent his days on deck wearing pajamas? Which one patiently pulled a parasitic worm out of his leg, all 2 feet of it? What was the oddest thing about our hairiest pirate? Who kept her pirate ship tethered to the bedpost in her castle? Who personally led his crew in religious services twice a day? Who provoked the most mutinies against him? And which pirate sprinkled her troops with garlic water before raids? The second myth about piracy is that it ended centuries ago. In fact, it continues to this day, mostly in areas where crushing poverty coexists with unpoliced oceans. There are hundreds of pirate attacks on ships every year, especially around the Philippines, Indonesia, parts of South America, Nigeria, and Somalia. Now the targets are often oil and gas tankers or ships carrying drugs. We see today's pirates as thieves and murderers on the high seas, and if they operate out of political or religious beliefs, as terrorists. Yet pirates from centuries past will always capture our imagination. Here, presented chronologically, as factually as possible, but mentioning the more credible rumors, are the lives of some 20 men and women. A gallery of villains. A journey through spectacular geography and a window into world history. Kathleen Krull. A Case of Cold Feet? Elvilda, mid-400s, Scandinavian princess turned pirate. Alvilda was a wild young princess of the Goths, an East Germanic tribe that lived in what is now Sweden. Her father, king of the Goths, arranged an excellent marriage for her to Prince Alf of Denmark. Apparently, Alvilda was unenthusiastic. She ran away and became a pirate instead. Leaving behind cozy royal robes of fox and squirrel, she dressed in men's clothes, with cold armor and a helmet, foregoing fancy meals of whale or seal meat with berries or hazelnuts, washed down with wine or beer. She lived a harsh life on her ship. She recruited other noble women seeking adventure, and as a gang, they raided vessels along the icy Atlantic coast. After capturing a ship whose captain had died, Alvilda took over the crew and commanded equal numbers of men and women. Prince Alf, not taking the hint, decided to get his own ship and go pirate hunting. After his ship followed a suspicious vessel into the Gulf of Finland, dangerous with ice, a bloody battle erupted. His men surged aboard. Alf ordered the captain to be brought before him. He removed the captain's helmet. Behold, it was Alvilda, just as he had hoped. He immediately proposed again, and this time she accepted. Alvilda retired from piracy, had a daughter, and ended up as Queen of Denmark. She may or may not have actually existed. Her story was recorded by a monk named Saxo Grammaticus, who wasn't fussy about fact or fiction in his History of the Danes in the Middle Ages. Women of Alvilda's era were tough, with much authority. If Saxo Grammaticus made the story up, he may have intended to warn women against straying from their proper role, staying home and being pretty. But if Alvilda did exist, she was the first known female pirate. It would take another 1,000 years for the next rebellious woman to appear in the pirate records.
Terror with Red Beards. The Barbarossa Brothers. Aruj, 1473-1518. Kyr, 1475-1546. Greek brothers who made the Barbary states of North Africa notorious for piracy. The Muslim Ottoman Empire was mighty, but not powerful enough to control two red-haired pirates. And why would it? Like many pirates throughout history, the Barbarossa brothers were more of a help than a problem for those in power. Aruj and Kyr grew up in a haven for local pirates, the Greek island of Lesbos. They were two of four sons born to a Muslim retired soldier and a Christian Greek woman said to be the widow of a priest. As Aruj and Kyr grew older and sprouted carrot-colored beards, Barbarossa, Red Beard, became their mutual nickname. The four brothers worked first as sailors. Some of them turned pirate to counter the raids by the Knights of St. John, who were Christian pirates operating out of the island of Rhodes. One brother was killed, another disappeared, and then Aruj was captured by the Knights, imprisoned, and sold as a galley slave. His younger brother, Kyr, meanwhile, was learning 6 languages and becoming an outstanding engineer. Aruj managed to escape and make his way to Egypt. The Sultan, readying a fleet of ships to send to India, put one under Aruj's command. Aruj sent for Kyr, found a crew of sailors, and joined the centuries-long holy war between Christians and Muslims. As pirates, they attacked ships and islands of the Mediterranean controlled by Christians. Their most valuable prizes were people, many of whom were then enslaved in the city of Algiers, capital of Algeria in North Africa. At one time, Algiers claimed to have 30,000 slaves, the most famous being Miguel Cervantes, who escaped and later wrote Don Quixote. On their ships, the Barbarossas used slaves to row their speedy galleys. Swiftness was a major weapon in their hit-and-run attacks. Although Kyr was the engineer,
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.